Chapter 4, Miracle in Tent City. We called it Tent City. Everybody called it Tent City, although it was neither a city nor a town. It was a farm worker labor camp owned by Shihei Strawberry Farms. Tent City had no address. It was simply known as rural Santa Maria. It was on Main Street, about 10 miles east of the center of town. Half a mile east of it were hundreds of acres of strawberries cultivated by Japanese sharecroppers and harvested by people from the camp. Behind Tent City was dry wilderness, and a mile north of it was a city dump. Many of the residents in the camp were single men, most of whom, like us, had crossed the border illegally. There were a few single women and a few families, all Mexican. My mom was already expecting when we moved to Tent City from Corcoran at the end of January, after the cotton season was over. By May, when a strawberry harvest started, she was only a few weeks away from giving birth, so she did not join Papa in the fields picking strawberries for Ito. She could not bend over, and picking on her knees was too hard on her. To make ends meet, Mama cooked for 20 farm workers who lived in Tent City. She made their lunches and had supper ready for them when they returned from picking strawberries at the end of the day. She would get up at 4 o'clock every morning, 7 days a week, to make the tortillas for both meals. On weekends, and all during the summer, Roberto and I helped her. Once Papa left for work, Roberto rolled the tacos while I wrapped them in wax paper and put them in lunch bags. At 11:30, Roberto carried the 20 lunches in a box and delivered them on foot to the workers who were given half an hour for lunch. When he returned, he and I washed dishes in a large aluminum tub. We then took care of our younger brother, Trampita, who Mama took a nap. Around 3 o'clock, she would start cooking dinner, which was served from 6 to 7. After supper, Roberto and I again cleaned the pots and washed dishes while Mama fed Trampita. On Saturdays, she did all of the grocery shopping for the week. Because we did not have an icebox, Papa made one. Every 3 days, he went into town to buy a large block of ice, which he wrapped in a burlap and placed inside a hole he dug in the ground by the entrance to our tent. The hole was twice as large as the block of ice, leaving room on all four sides and on top for things to be kept cold. Even though Mama was always tired from all the work she did, she made sure everything was ready for the new baby. She asked Papa to seal the base of the tent by piling extra dirt about 6 inches high all around it outside so that animals, especially snakes, could not crawl underneath during the night. When Papa had finished, Mama pleaded with him to build a floor. He agreed, and every evening after he came home from work, he sent Roberto and me to the city dump to look for discarded lumber to build a floor inside our tent. Our trip to the dump was always an adventure. We waited until dusk, after the dump caretaker left, before raiding for treasures because we had no money to buy them. When he went home in the evenings, the caretaker locked the more valuable items, such as used clothing, car parts, and broken lamps, in a makeshift shed. The larger pieces, mattresses, box springs, broken pieces of furniture, he left outside, leaning against the storehouse. Besides lumber, I collected books, hoping to read them once I learned how. My favorites were those with pictures. Late one evening, thinking the caretaker had left, Roberto and I sneaked into the dump. The dump keeper, who had hidden behind one of the mounds of rubbish, took us by surprise. He chased us, yelling and cursing in broken Spanish. We were scared and went home empty-handed that night, but we went back several more times until we got enough lumber to complete Mama's floor. We also found pieces of linoleum and laid them over the wood to cover the holes and slivers. The different shapes and colors made the floor look like a quilt. On one of our trips, we found a large wooden box that became the crib for the new baby. Mama took an old green army blanket, tore it in half, and lined the box with it. She made a little pillow with stuffing from an old mattress and cloth from a white flour sack. Mama also made sure the entrance to her tent was always closed to keep out the smoke and odor from the camp's garbage dump located directly in front of our tent, 20 yards away. It was a large rectangular hole dug in the dirt, about 6 feet long by 4 feet wide and 3 feet deep. On windy days, the foul smell of the city dump competed with the stench of the Tent City dump. The older neighborhood kids killed snakes and threw them in the garbage hole when it was burning and watched them sizzle and squirm. I could not figure out why they twisted and turned in the fire after they were dead. It was as though the fire brought them back to life. One shrimp pita got too close to the garbage hole and fell in. Roberto pulled him out. Luckily, it was not burning. From then on, Papa did not let us play near it. When the baby was finally born, Roberto, Trampita, and I were excited to see him, especially because we had worked so hard to get things ready for him. Papa and Mama named him Juan Manuel, but we called him Torito, or Little Bull, because he weighed 10 pounds at birth. He had a chubby, round face and curly brown hair. I thought the nickname Torito fitted him because he had a strong grip. I would put two of my fingers in his tiny hand, and when I tried pulling away, he would not let go and would kick with both feet. When Mama nursed him, he closed his eyes and played with her hair. Whenever I changed his diaper, I made him laugh by tickling his stomach. I liked playing with Torito because he was always cheerful and because he helped me forget about the report card I got in early June, a few days before he was born. Miss Galipino, my first grade teacher, said I had to repeat her class because I did not know English. About 2 months after he was born, Torito got sick. I knew there was something wrong with him when he cried off and on all during the night. The next morning, when I tickled him, he did not even smile. He looked pale. Mama, who had not slept much that night either, touched his forehead. "I think Torito has a fever," she said, a bit flustered. "Please look after him while Roberto and I prepare the lunches." I touched my forehead and then Torito's to see if I could tell the difference. His felt a lot hotter. I then changed his soiled diaper. It smelled terrible. That afternoon, Mama had to change him often. His thighs and bottom got as red as the back of Papa's sunburned neck.